Welcome. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Sterling, to both those present online and in person. I am Rosalie Clavey. I am the coordinator of the Worship Associate Team and a Worship Associate here at UU Sterling. Our minister, Reverend Ashley Burczak, is not able to be with us this morning, but I want you to know she planned this service for us and she pre-recorded the sermon. Here is a short video from her about why she is not here. We'll follow the video with a gathering hymn.
Well, I was not hoping to give my second sermon by video, even a little bit. However, as the parents among you know, when you have young kids, pretty much every COVID spike is an event for your household. So my son tested positive on Wednesday, and I tested positive on Thursday. I'm fine. I just want to be sure I'm protecting you by quarantining. I am so looking forward to being together with you again on the 24th for our in-gathering service.
Please rise as you are willing and able. We're gonna sing number 368 from the Gray Hymnal. It's called Now Let Us Sing. Now this song requires a little bit of parts to happen. So on the next slide, you'll see that they're divided. You've got the lowest part, which is kind of the call on the left, and then you have the higher part, which is more of the melody, the response, on the right. So it's like, now let us sing, and then sing to the power of the faith within, now let us sing. So if you're not familiar with it, there's plenty of people in the room that are. Pick a side, and then when you get to this part, this is all together. Sing to the power of the faith within, then sing, sing to the power of the faith within. Now let us sing, sing to the power of the faith within. Lift up your voice, be not afraid. Sing to the power of the faith within. Now let us sing, sing to the power, hope within. Now let us sing, sing to the power of the hope within. Lift up your voice, lift up. You may be seated.
Good morning. I have a few announcements. Welcome to this place of fellowship and peace, renewal and deepening, engagement and reflection. My name is Bill Roman. It is my honor to serve this congregation as a member of the Board of Trustees. Whoever you are, wherever you come from, whatever your identity, age, ability, or history, know that you are welcome to bring your full self here. I have a few announcements. If you are a visitor, we are so glad you're here. To learn more, you're invited to join our virtual coffee hour after the service or reach out to me or Rosalie or any of the people you see up here to discuss Unitarian Universalism. The congressional ingathering and water ceremony, officially kicking off the start of the new church season, will be held on Sunday, September 24th. You're invited to bring water for the service either from your travels or from your home. Please come to celebrate together, and we will create sacred water from the mingling of water from many sources. I would like to thank Rosalie for her extra work this morning, making sure that our coffee hour service is going to go work after the service. So thank you, Rosalie. Rosalie does a lot of amazing things around here, and we should always thank her profusely. So. Finally, I would like you to invite you to share a greeting with those around you, both those you know and those you have yet to meet. Good morning. Now let us share worship with reverence and authenticity. Please join me in our invocation. The words will appear on your screen. This is another day we have been given. This is indeed a sacred day. Let us be grateful for the capacity to sense, feel, and understand. Let us be grateful for the incredible gift of life, and let us be especially grateful for the ties of love which bind us together, giving dignity, meaning, worth, and joy to all of our days.
Good morning. Despite what it says in your order of service, my name is Sharon, not Rosalie. The chalice lighting this morning is from French writer Anaïs Nin. We do not grow absolutely. Chronologically, we grow sometimes in one dimension and not in another, unevenly. We grow partially. We are relative. We are mature in one realm, childish in another. The past, present, and future mingle and pull us backward, forward, or fix us in the present. We are made of layers, cells, constellations.
Our chalice hymn is number 1, May Nothing Evil Cross This Door. You may stay seated and we'll sing it. The words will appear on your screen. We'll sing all 4 verses.
Those
To welcome all those who are chronologically young and all those who are spiritually young to come forward and enjoy a story or something approaching a story. We'll talk. Yeah, there's something for, there's actually more than one thing in there, so you can just take a look. Go ahead. Yep, go ahead. Yep. So, yeah, and then. Yeah, there's a, yep, above that, what does it say? Yes, it's sandpaper.
And then this thing.
Yeah. Yeah, and do the balls feel different, other than being round and the other object being square, do the balls and the wood square feel different?
Yeah.
Okay, can you?
This one's smooth.
Yeah, that one's smooth, and then.
Yeah,
that's right. Right, the sandpaper is very scratchy, that's right. And then how does that feel? And that is silk, but it doesn't have to be silk. But how does that feel, that cloth that's on your lap there?
It's soft.
It's soft and very, very smooth, yeah. Yeah, mm-hmm, yeah. Feels nice, doesn't it? Okay, and so we have a square of wood, which is actually a coaster, which is very smooth, and we have these balls that are rough, okay? So what if you had to make that rough, those rough balls smooth like that coaster? What, yep, mm-hmm, that's right. So you wouldn't use the silk, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm, because the silk has no rough edges, and it can't wear off the rough edges of those balls. Yeah, yeah. So the sandpaper is a more effective tool for this. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So sometimes to make something smooth, you need to have something that is rough and hard to wear down the edges, okay, right? Mm-hmm. And sometimes things can be like that in life, too. Something is a challenge, but because it's a challenge, it's hard, it helps us to learn. Mm-hmm. Helps us to be a little more expansive in how we are with other people. Mm-hmm. Okay, and how do you get better at reading? When you read an easy book, or where you know all the words already, or when you read a book that has some words,
the hard book
that has some words that you don't know yet? And sometimes that's kind of tough when you have a book that has a lot of words that you don't know. I've been practicing a word this past week. It doesn't come from a book, but it just comes from my life, and that word is nonagenarian. Mm-hmm, Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like that word. You know, it has a nice sound in your mouth. It means that somebody that is in the is between 90 and 99. Not me. I want to clear. I'm not 99. I'm not 90. No. Do any of you play an instrument?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I know I do.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Violin.
I play the cello.
Uh-huh. And so how do you get better at playing an instrument? By playing songs that you know that are easy, or by playing
new
songs that are a little harder?
Low. This is
fingers.
Hard.
Uh-huh.
It's not letting go of my hand.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So do you guys want
to play an instrument, Arthur?
I play an instrument.
You do?
Several instruments.
Yeah?
My
wow.
voice.
What? Yes.
My voice,
yes.
Piano.
Uh-huh.
And trying to make him stop whining. Those are the instruments I play.
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
and recorder, right?
Yes.
Natasha, the
recorder. Yes.
Record.
Where you play.
Yeah.
Mr. Piano Boy.
And so do you like playing music that you don't know?
I like making up music. I like singing up my own songs. I like trying to match the notes on the piano with the notes on a song paper thing.
Uh-huh. And so do you notice that as you're
paper.
Trying all those things, it gets a little easier?
What?
And do you, as you're trying new songs and trying to find the notes and the rhythms, do you notice that it gets easier to learn something new? Yes.
Like that's music.
Mm-hmm. Well, I, and sometimes the things that help us learn the most in school and at home are really hard. And sometimes the things that help us learn to be kinder and wiser can be hard too. But hopefully we can use the sandpaper in life to make something beautiful. So thank you very much for being here. And well, I'd like to take that. You see, that one was made especially for me by my sister-in-law. So I would really like to keep that one.
What about this?
Well, that one I kind of would like to keep too. But you know what? You guys can have. If you want the cedar balls, you can have those.
Yay.
Yeah, and you can play with it. You can take the sandpaper with you and play with it back in RE. That would be fine.
We hold you in our love as you go. May your heart be at peace as you go. To nurture the spark of your precious life, we hold you in our love as you go.
The ritual of sharing our sorrows and our joys invites us to hear one another and heal one another. You are invited to briefly share great losses or milestones. If you are in the sanctuary, I invite you to stand and share your name or joy or sorrow. And if you are online, and I invite you to share your joy or sorrow in the chat box, and I will give each one voice. As you share, we will place a stone from the dry bowl into the bowl of water.
I have a friend, a coworker I've worked with for over 20 years, who is going to have brain surgery on September 20th. To remove a benign tumor that he's been fighting for several years. So please keep him in your thoughts, my friend Wes. Thank you.
This is not really a joy or a sorrow, but more of a thank you. Last week when I tried to come to church, and then we were having a problem with a squatter in Jonah's apartment in New York, and I came in to give Nancy and Jack some auction stuff that I had promised, and thankfully, it just happened that as soon as I drove in, Jack and Nancy drove up so I could give me hugs and help me deal with just my stress that I was having at that moment. And then when I put the thing in Joys and Sorrows online, because I was watching the service online, literally within minutes, the clouds sort of parted, and the squatter decided she was actually finally going to leave after we had been working for days to try to get her out. And it was always like two steps forward, one steps back, and it was incredible. And you all just brought me to tears. I felt your love and your energy, and I just totally believe in like the juju that people like send you. So we're not out of the woods yet. There's still the property management company to deal with, and they're very scummy. And so we're dealing with that, but. So some more of that would be wonderful. Thank you.
We got you.
I have a joy to share. Last Friday, I completed a course in CPR and in other kinds of safety, which was prompted by my granddaughter, who in our community, we were driving back, and there was a gentleman on the ground, and we turned around, and she immediately said, "I know CPR," and went to work on him. So I'm very grateful that she inspired me and that I completed this goal.
Good morning, I'm Christine. I wanted a public service announcement because COVID is on the rise, if you're not aware, but I think many of you know I have a cousin who has brain cancer, and he just came down with COVID. He got it from a coworker, and my aunt and uncle in that same family, they were all at a wedding, and they got it, and they were in the hospital because they both are immunocompromised. Thankfully, they're stable at the moment, but I just wanted to remind everybody to be safe, and please pray for them.
Online this morning, just a greeting from Kim Cleland to all of you.
I love Kim, she's awesome. I'm sorry to bring more rain. I've been struggling missing my dad, and what's been weird is I'm from Florida, and like when I've been seeing the lightning outside, like it, I feel like it's reaching into my soul, and like I've been finding myself just like crying. It's just so weird how like some things will just like trigger stuff. And anyway, I have lots of joys too, but like it's just, that's just been so weird an experience that I just wanted to share that you're, you know, not alone if you're also having weird things that are like bringing you into a moment of sadness all of a sudden. So good luck to you on your journeys as well.
We will place one more stone for all those joys or sorrows we hold in our hearts, especially those still too tender to be shared aloud. Please continue now with us in a space of silence for prayer or meditation as you are called. Let's follow this silence with the spoken meditation, which Sharon will bring to you.
The meditation today is called Blessing for Kin, and it's from UU Minister Sean Dennison Parker. I wish you a single story, not a simple fairy tale with only happiness, but one life without secrets or omissions, without the need for fake faces, one pointing outward, the other inward and real. I wish for you the twin beauties of clarity and consistency, knowing the singular word that holds all of you together, all of you at once, all of you. I wish you no need to hide, no reason to live in shadows or half-truths, no need to cover the spark and sparkle of your heart to keep it from catching the light of sun or moon. I wish you wholeheartedness that arises from the liberty before needing to be freed, the completeness that precedes the breaking, the integrity of your being, a unity undivided and boundless. I wish for you a far-reaching welcome from within, full and absolute acceptance, nothing withheld from yourself, unrealized or unfinished. And I wish you a place and a people who do not want you in pieces, incomplete and partial. A world that no longer asks anyone to wrench apart their heart or divide soul from mind, from nature, from core. I bless you with all that is whole. Let us pause now to reflect in silence.
Sharon, thank you for that beautiful reading. That reading comes from a book of UU, out of the UU meditation series, and I have that book with me if anybody wants to see it. And so going on now with the with reading Invictus by William Ernest Henley, and this poem is said to have been recited by Mandela in his prison cell. Out of the night that covers me, black as the pit from pole to pole, I thank whatever gods may be for my unconquerable soul. In the fell clutch of circumstances, I have not winced or cried aloud. Under the bludgeonings of chance, my head is bloody,
but unbowed. Beyond this place of wrath and tears looms but the horror of the shade, and yet the menace of the years finds and shall find me unafraid. It matters not how straight the gate, how charged with punishments the scroll, I am the master of my fate. I am the captain of my soul.
So I'm reprising a song that I have sung before, per request by Reverend Ashley. This is the song that she requested to go along with her sermon today. But because I've sung it before, I'd like to call this a congregational anthem. So as I'm singing, if you feel moved, the lyrics will be on the screen. And it's a popular song that you've heard on the radio, possibly. So if you feel moved, you are welcome to join me. You can be amazing, you can turn a phrase into a weapon or a drug. You can be the outcast or be the backlash of somebody's lack of love. Or you can start speaking up. Nothing's gonna hurt you the way that words do when they settle neath your skin. Kept on the inside and no sunlight, sometimes the shadow wins. But I wonder what would happen if you say what you wanna say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I wanna see you be brave with what you wanna say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I wanna see you be brave. I just wanna see you. I just wanna see you. Just wanna see you. I wanna see you be brave. I just wanna see you. I just wanna see you. I just wanna see you. Everybody's been there, everybody's been stared down by the enemy. Fallen for the fear and dance of disappearing. Bow down to the mighty. Don't run. Stop holding your tongue. Maybe there's a way out of the cage where you live. Maybe one of these days you can let the light in. Show me how big your brave is. Say what you wanna say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I wanna see you be brave with what you wanna say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I wanna see you be brave. And since your history of silence won't do you any good, did you think it would? Let the words be anything but empty. Why don't you tell them the truth? Say what you wanna say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I wanna see you be brave with what you wanna say and let the words fall out. Honestly, I wanna see you be brave. I just wanna see you. I just wanna see you. I just wanna see you. I wanna see you be brave. I just wanna see you. I just wanna see you. I just wanna see you. See you be brave. I just wanna see you. See you be brave. I just wanna see you. I just wanna see you. Just wanna see you.
On Valentine's Day this year, our son Pierce's teacher welcomed the class by asking what Valentine's Day celebrates. I think the answer she was looking for was love, but when you have a pastor's kid in your third grade class, you might get more than you bargained for sometimes. Pierce raised his hand, and he proceeded to give the class a thorough exposition on Roman history, the requirement in the time of St. Valentinus that young men not marry so they could better serve the military, the martyrdom of St. Valentinus at the hands of Roman authorities due to his refusal to follow the decree against marrying potential legionaries. We could hope that the impromptu lesson didn't dive too deeply into the nitty-gritty of Roman execution methods. I am grateful his teacher didn't ask about Christmas. In response to Pierce's lecture, his teacher, just unflappable, simply said, "Well, we all got a history lesson today," and went on with the process of exchanging the Pokemon Valentines. There are times when all of us get more than we bargained for. Public school teachers are no doubt more accustomed to such things and more able to call up the calm in the face of the unexpected that helps find the opportunity there. Maybe we could all take a cue from them as we try to find our way after what we can all agree has been 3 very strange years. Though it has been a hard time, that doesn't mean everything from it is bad. Like Valentine's Day, a joyful celebration of love born out of dark days, good can eventually come from hardship. We get chocolates on February 14th. Could be worse. The term post-traumatic growth is usually used to describe the positive changes that individuals can show in the wake of trauma. Changes like the development of better coping skills, more empathy, more humor and equanimity. We've all probably known people who have become better in the wake of suffering, and others who could probably do with a little more hardship to help put things in perspective. Post-traumatic growth is by no means inevitable, but research shows that for individuals and communities who are open to change, it is possible. You might be surprised to hear that Stephen Colbert, the late night host, is also a deeply sensitive and spiritual thinker. Colbert's father and 2 brothers died in a plane crash when he was 10. And here's what he said about that horrible tragedy. "It's a gift to exist. And with existence comes suffering. There's no escaping that. I don't want it to have happened. I want it not to have happened. But if you're grateful for life, which I think is a positive thing to do, not everybody is, and I'm not always, but it's the most positive thing to do, then you have to be grateful for all of it. You can't pick and choose what you're grateful for." It can be hard work to be grateful for life. There are things that we want not to have happened. But sometimes we find these great examples of ways that hardship brings out the best of humanity. I think of Viktor Frankl, who survived the Holocaust and taught so many how to find meaning in the face of horror. I think of Nelson Mandela, who maintained his dignity while imprisoned for over 20 years. His Holiness the Dalai Lama, who lost his entire country and yet is filled with this irrepressible joy. Each one is such an example to us, and none of them possible without unspeakable loss and pain. Queer culture is a master class in the creation of beauty out of struggle. Through some magical alchemy and a lot of hard work, a community was able to make a beautiful kaleidoscope of color and creativity and celebration out of the raw material of beatings and bullying and persecution. It's nothing short of a miracle. Post-traumatic growth is really part of why we say elders are wise, isn't it? Life isn't always easy, and those who have lived for a little longer have probably had to experience and grow from more challenges. What I find most intriguing about research into post-traumatic growth is work that's focused on the role of courage in moving people forward in these situations. In order to grow from trauma, we need two things. Externally, enough support that the trauma doesn't simply consume us, and internally, enough courage to change. I think support looks like reaching out again to each other, building relationships, even though it probably still feels a little weird. Being willing to sit with the vulnerability of meeting new people, and of course, finding ways to build relationships that are responsible and inclusive, given the ongoing realities of COVID. Courage looks like sitting with ambiguity and hard feelings. We only grow from trauma when we don't avoid its realities. We felt a lot of pressure to act like COVID never happened. But life has changed. People are less engaged on a societal level. Social divisions run deeper than I have ever experienced. Nearly everyone is in a state of rebuilding identity, which is hard work. One recent study showed that 40% of the population is experiencing clinically significant anxiety. And long-term anxiety changes the brain. If everyone seems a little off, it's because we are. Our brains are plastic, and healing is always possible. But that healing isn't going to happen like a light switch turning on. It can't happen without our emotional presence. You might have noticed that church has changed too. For our communities, support and courage looks like building ways to connect to each other that adjust for these realities. We might need more creativity, new kinds of activities, smaller groups or one-on-one connections. We're here to realize the promise of beloved community. Not perfect community, where no one makes mistakes, or a convenient community that does everything exactly our way, but a community based on love in practice. Beginning with our small circle and supporting each other to expand outwards again and again and again. I don't know if any of you have ever seen the musical In the Heights by Lin-Manuel Miranda, but there's a moment in it that speaks deeply to me, in part because of my own family's story of struggle as part of the Puerto Rican diaspora, in part because I loved many neighborhoods in New York City before gentrification destroyed them, and in part because the core of that struggle of feeling powerless in the face of a world that does not value what is truly valuable is so much a reflection of our lives in recent years. In this scene, the characters discuss the death of their neighborhood. One character tells another to give up and despair because they are powerless as gentrification forces them out. And lucky for you, I'm not going to rap. But the other one responds, "All right, we're powerless. So light up a candle." And he goes on, "Maybe we're powerless. However, how do you want to face it? When a virus blows our lives apart, and the outdoors we retreat to for safety becomes unlivable from heat and smoke and storms from climate change, and even those two world-changing events are a drop in the bucket among many seemingly overwhelming existential threats We can decide we're powerless. Or we can be reminded of the wonder of how small this little blue dot in the vastness of space is, how fragile we are, how connected, how we need the same simple things and we need each other. If we begin from that place of vast love, whatever we do next will be something that's worth doing. And it's worth doing whether we succeed or not, because acting from a place of love is what makes a good and meaningful life. Whatever we build or save, even on the largest scale, nothing is permanent. Not any measure of success or failure we might attach ourselves to. But that impermanence isn't what defines us. No matter what comes our way, the one thing we always control is our response to it. There will always be hard things, some that we can't control. But how do we want to face them? Let me propose joy and hope and celebration, because it beats the alternatives. If Valentinus could affirm love in the face of the weight of the most powerful military in the world, we can choose that courage too. Just about nothing is as we hoped it would be a few years ago. But maybe we're wiser. And maybe there are more things we've learned to be grateful for. We are here with the only time we've ever had to do anything, which is right now. This moment is the best and only moment to grow. Have courage.
It is now time for our offering. We have received freely of gifts that minister to our needs of body and spirit. May we now give gladly a portion of that bounty. 2/3 of the cash offering will support our congregation. The remaining 1/3 will go to support our justice cause. This month, it is Mobile Hope. Mobile Hope is a nonprofit that provides support and emergency shelter to youth up to age 24 and who are at risk, precariously housed or unhoused, and empowers them to become self-sufficient and experience improved well-being. The Washingtonian named Mobile Hope one of the 20 DC area charities where your donation will make an impact. A donation bin for clothing and goods is always at the back of the sanctuary under the name tags. If you are in the sanctuary, you may place your donations in the baskets as they are passed. Online attendees can use the donate button in the virtual order of service. Donations may also be made via mail or via the Donate tab on the UUCS homepage. Please note when your donation is towards your pledge. Thank you for your generosity to our congregation and our community.
Thank you, Mary. I was singing the words along in my heart. As we prepare to conclude our service, you are invited to reach out your hands and hearts into the space of this community to join in a virtual circle inclusive of all. First, let us extinguish our chalice while we carry forth its light in our hearts. Please join us in our covenant. This congregation is dedicated to the proposition that behind all our differences and beneath all our diversities, there is a unity that binds us together and makes us one in spite of time and death and the space between the stars. We pause now in silent witness to that unity. At this moment of ending, may there be a good word, a blessing, to help us remember what we have so often forgotten. May the message we need be gently spoken and held in the spaces of ourselves. The fibers that hold all we need to maintain our gentleness, our courage, and our hope. At this moment of ending, may the goodness we wish for ourselves and each other, this community, ecosystem, planet, and stardust galaxy become such a part of us that we cannot tell where the blessing ends and we begin.
For our closing hymn today, we're singing number 1029, Love Knocks and Waits for Us to Hear. And I just want to say, you know, it seems a little interesting to finish a service on a minor note. This has a minor key, kind of a more contemplative sound. But what I see with bravery and courage, so you can't just be given it like the lion in Wizard of Oz. It's something you find every single time that you challenge yourself or try something or put yourself out there. So I let us leave here on a minor sounding music because for me, I always feel like I need a resolution in no matter what minor key I'm in, even if it ends perfect. So I just challenge you to continue to stretch yourself and be brave. So stand and join me in singing our final hymn. Love knocks and waits for us to hear.
Love knocks and waits.
After the service to set up the coffee hour. You can find the Zoom link in the order of service. Have a blessed day.